Thank you very much. Good morning. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present this overdose crisis from a global perspective. And I will give you the overview from the European Monitoring Center for Drugs and Drug Addiction. So thank you very much for this invitation. I will say a few words on the agency, the European Monitoring Center for Drugs and Drug Addiction, the ENCDDA, is the reference point on drugs and drug addiction information in Europe. And I'm actually now sitting in this building that you see here. The agency has been inaugurated in Lisbon, Portugal, in 1995, and it's one of the EU's decentralized agencies. We're working with a network of focal points in the 27 EU member states, Norway and Turkey, as you can see on the map. And we work with the national experts of these focal points, and as well with some established networks across Europe, for example, network of drug checking services, of wastewater analysis, of hospital emergency surveillance and sentinel system. I will present first some of the highlights of the European Drug Report 2021. And as you may know, this report is actually composed by this report on trends and developments, where we have the detailed analysis of the drug situation in Europe, and it's translated in over 24 languages. And there's as well the statistical bulletin, it's full of data and the methods. And it's important to go through this report because it gives us the background before going into this topic of drug-related deaths. So what we saw in what is reported here is that the drug market has been resilient to COVID-19 disruption. And I think that's important because it gives us the situation in terms of the drugs that are available in Europe before talking about the people. So I suggest the following outline for this presentation. We will have a look at the background and at selected highlights from this 2021 report, and mainly about things that are related to drug-related harms. We see then the overdose and see how there is a European patchwork, but there are some common concerns across the country. Then we will see what is the impact, what was the impact of the pandemic, and what are the responses. So what do we do in Europe in terms of monitoring of responses, and then the next steps. So the European drug situation, if we want to put it that in three words, we can say it's everywhere, everything and everybody. Everywhere because there has been lots of imported drug. We had very important seizures, imports in Turkey, in Belgium, but others as well. And we've got as well some locally manufactured drugs. There were more than 370 laboratories that were dismantled in 2019. And it's reflecting the increased and the diversified production of drugs, both the established and the new drugs. What you see here as well is a laboratory. And we had laboratories producing heroin and producing other drugs as well. What we've noticed as well is that there has been an increased availability, purity, and variety of drugs available. And I will just give you some examples, starting first with opioids, and in particular with heroin. There were large seizures, and that signaled a potential for increased use and harms, of course. What you see on the top is the number of seizures in the EU 27 and in the in EU plus Turkey and Norway. And you see at the bottom that there was actually 7.9 tons of heroin size in the EU and 20 tons in Turkey in 2019. Meanwhile, the heroin purity remained really high. The retail price was relatively low, so suggesting high availability of the drug. Heroin was the third most common substance in drug-related acute toxicity presentation in 2019. That's based on our network, Euroden, which is a Sentinel Hospital surveillance. And opioids, of course, were mainly, with mainly heroin, were often with other substances, they were present in most fatal overdose. We had other opioids like methadone mainly, but as well, to a lesser extent, we had some cases with buprenorphine, with fentanyl, and sometimes the oxycodone or tramadol, but we talk later about these. So there were opioids, but as well, and similar to what's happening in the US and in Canada, we had stimulants, and in particular, cocaine. What we see here is that we had record seizures of cocaine, and that indicates expanding supply. On the top, you see the number of seizures, and at the bottom, you see how the volume, the number of tons of cocaine has actually tripled from 2016 to 2019. And meanwhile, we had from the wastewater cities, the surveillance of the wastewater, we see that in most of the cities, we saw an increase in the amount of cocaine or cocaine metabolites detected. And then while the price was almost stable over the years, what you see at the top is that the purity of cocaine has considerably increased over the years. And this increase in purity is not only for cocaine, but it was seen as well in other stimulants, in particular such as MDMA, ecstasy, and the average quantity of MDMA in pills of ecstasy was 177 milligrams, which is much higher than what we could see in many countries some years ago. There were other concerns about from opioids and stimulants. We saw in particular new benzodiazepine with the increasing availability on the drug market. We had 30 new benzodiazepines that were monitored by the early warning system. And 80% of them were first detected between 2014 and 20, and organized crime groups were producing them. So these drugs together increase the availability of drugs that are potentially associated to drug-related harms. We can now, with this background in mind, we can move to looking at the people. And we see that we've got really different kind of people who are concerned by drug use. And here what we will have, of course, is the focus on drug-related deaths. So this is what we published a few days ago in the European Drug Report. We saw that there were 5,141 deaths reported for the European Union in 2019. And it's just a slight increase compared to the revised figure for the year before. If we consider as well Turkey and Norway, so the EU plus two countries, we have 5,769 people who died in 2019 in Europe. We had three quarters of people were males. The mean age was 42 years, and we will see that we've got really this aging trends in terms of drug-related deaths. But however, as you can see, there were still 9% of the people who were really young. They were aged less than 25 years when they died of a drug overdose. In terms of the drugs, we saw three quarters of the deaths were actually related to opioids. Let's have a look again at the numbers, but at the trend between the year 2009 and 2019. Here, what you see is that we had in this graph the countries with the highest number of deaths. We had Turkey and Norway in the orange color. And as you see, there was this really peak of deaths, in particularly in Turkey in 2016-17. It was mostly related to synthetic cannabinoids. We've got as well Spain, which accounts for a large number of deaths. But here the pattern is different because we've got cocaine involved in half the cases of deaths in Spain. Then Sweden, where it's more related to different opioids. And Germany, which is more the pattern of heroin and opioid use. It's important, of course, to consider numbers, but we need to look at the drug-related death rates, per million population age 1564. And what you see at the bottom of the slide, this green light is the this green line is the EU EU plus two country average mortality rate. We had 15 deaths per million population aged 1564. And before I go to the details of some of the countries showed here, it's important to put this number in perspective with what's happening in the US and in Canada as well. In the US in 2019, there were 70,000 people who died of a drug overdose, and that corresponds to a mortality rate that is actually 15 times higher than this mortality rate, the average European mortality rate. And in Canada, it's a similar picture, which is a really completely of a different scale compared to what we see at the moment in Europe. We can have a look at these countries that are those who had the highest mortality rates related to overdose. You see Sweden, Norway, Ireland, Finland, and as we can see in the next slide, these countries, as well as Denmark, they are mostly in the north of Europe. We've got higher mortality in the north of Europe, but of course, the differences are to be considered with caution, because there is an underestimation in some countries. It has been reported, for example, by Romania, but to a lesser extent as well too by France. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that there is, of course, different prevalence of high-risk drug use in these countries. And that means opioid use in particular, but as well injecting drug use. There are differences in the mortality rates related to overdose, but there are differences as well, you will see, in the type of people who have been who died of an overdose. And let's have a look at the age distribution of the drug-induced deaths reported in the European Union, Turkey and Norway in 2019. What you see in the pale blue is the proportion of deaths that occurred before 30 years. And from the left side of the slide, you see that it's in Turkey, in Bulgaria, in Hungary, in Austria, but as well as in Lithuania, Poland, Estonia, Latvia. So really the eastern part of Europe that we had the highest proportion of young people who died. And then if you look at the other side, you will see some countries, you know, we look at the dark blue, which is people who died after 40 years. You see countries like Spain, Portugal, France, Italy, where we had this heroin epidemic in the 90s, in the 80s, 90s, so people are in their late 40s or 50s now. And you see other countries in the north as well, like the Netherlands, Denmark, Norway, where the average age of the people who died is actually much higher than in the rest of Europe. And that means really some responses that need to be targeted, especially at these people who are much older now and at risk of overdose. We can have a look at the way it has changed since 2012. Here you see the number of drug-related deaths reported in all countries by age band and the difference between 2012 and 2019. And you see that from 12 to 19, the overdose deaths have increased overall. And it has increased in particular as well among the teenagers and among all categories above 35 years. So this is the background of the people who are dying of overdose in Europe at the moment. And of course, when the pandemic started, we were wondering what's going to happen? What's going to happen with this COVID-19 epidemic? Will we see a change in the number of deaths, in the profile of the people who are at risk? And of course, we had to start to think a bit differently, more rapidly. So we did this transporter exercise, which is a rapid assessment of the situation. Based on all focal points, some facilitated groups. It's a mixed method approach where we had some facilitated discussion, but we had as well some questionnaires and some surveys on the web. And what we were able to identify with our partners and our experts was that in terms of harms, there was actually a stable levels of drug presentations in the hospital. Here you see the number of acute drug toxicity presentations in the first three quarters of 2019 and 2020 among 10 selected Jordan plus hospital emergency services. And you see that for cocaine, for cannabis, heroin, benzo, GHB, and opioids, there was actually really stable levels of drug presentations. Sorry. But in for stimulants like MDMA, synthetic cannabinoids, and methamphetamine, we saw less presentations in 2020 compared to 2019. Here you can see the number of drug toxicity presentations in the period January to September from 2018 to 2020. And what you see here in Spain, Mallorca, Barcelona, but as well in Malta, in Oslo, in Norway, you see that the numbers in 2020, it's in red, they are almost similar to the numbers that were seen on the year before. And it's important to bear in mind that this actually occurred when there was a clear decrease in the overall number of presentations. For example, in Barcelona, in April 2020, there were 4,000 presentations in total, not only drugs, but all presentations. And these numbers actually half of what is seen in other years in Barcelona. So we had a look as well at some data on drug-related deaths. And what we saw is that it was overall stable in the four countries with the data available for 2020. As you know, there is always some delay to get the certification and the reporting of drug-related deaths, but at least for Czechia, Italy, Finland, and Portugal, the preliminary data and this partial picture really says that where we've got the data, there was no peak in drug overdose deaths. So, of course, we need to be cautious with this, but I think we can say so far, we have not seen the same phenomenon that was described for the US and for Canada. This said, we need to be really cautious because there are some new data coming, and we just had a look with the experts in Norway at the number of drug-induced deaths in the country from 2010 to 2020. And as you see, for the preliminary data for 2020, we really see this increase of the number of overdoses, and that involved heroin, but other drugs, other opioids as well. So we need to be very very aware of this risk of having, in some countries, a rebound, an increase in the number of deaths. So there will be more data coming coming from the countries in the next weeks. And we need to be very careful at the moment to communicate about the 2020 data. So that brings us to the responses and to what is done across Europe to prevent the drug-related deaths. So we will have a look at what was already there, what was available, and as well as what has changed with the pandemic. Our reference, it's important to mention that, is the European Union Drug Strategy. And the ideas behind this this framework are justice, respect of fundamental rights, equity and access to care, and a balanced approach with health and security put at the same level and seen as complementary. So in this framework, what has been developed for years in Europe is this, it's the integrated and complementary intervention. So here's just a reference to this health and social responses to drug problems. It's a European guide that we've published a few years ago, and that for which we are preparing a second edition. And the idea of this guide was to describe the interventions that are available, and in this particular case, what is available to reduce the risk of opioid-related deaths. And we've got three levels. The first one is reducing vulnerability with outreach and low-threshold services, enabling environment, empowering of drug users, and public health approach. The second level is reducing drug the risk of overdose. So that means retention, opioid substitution treatment, overdose risk assessment, and overdose awareness. And probably here now we could actually add the drug checking services that are still not mainstream, but that are more available now in many, many countries. And then the third level is reducing the fatal outcome of overdose. So that means supervised drug consumption rules and take-home naloxone programs. So we'll just focus on a very important one, which is retention and opioid substitution treatment, because there's so much evidence now for decades that opioid substitution treatment is largely a protective factor, and that OST, when it's well conducted and not interrupted, is really saving lives, not only lives lost due to overdose, but other both lives as well lost to other causes of death among people who are using drugs. So I just selected this review from Sarah Lamy and colleagues, but it adds to many other evidence of the protective effect of opioid agonist treatment. So where are we now in Europe with this opioid agonist treatment? We've got about 50% of the opioid-dependent persons in Europe who receive some form of opioid agonist treatment. But the national estimates vary from 10 to 80%. And there are heterogeneous situations, and treatment provision remains really insufficient in many parts of Europe. You can see on the left some of the countries for which we have the data. You notice that we miss data. We don't have any coverage estimate for many of the countries. But where we have this information, you see that in France, Slovenia, Greece, Malta, Croatia, Luxembourg, Austria, we had a coverage that was above 50%. What is interesting as well is that the principal opioid substitution drug prescribed differ across the countries. We've got many countries who have preferred methadone, but in the north of Europe, as well as in France and Turkey, it's more buprenorphine. There as well some initiatives with slow release or morphine. To complete this opioid agonist treatment approach, of course, there is as well, very importantly, the take-home naloxone, the safe consumption rooms, and the heroin-assisted treatment. And here what you see is the overview of where these responses are in place. And you see that while the opioid substitution treatment is now completely mainstream, as everywhere, it's not the case for the drug consumption rooms and for the take-home naloxone programs. I just give you a little focus on the supervised consumption facilities. So they are really these rooms. They are professionally supervised healthcare facilities in which the drug users can use drugs in safer and hygienic conditions under the supervision of trained staff. And in 2019, there were 64 facilities operating in 8 EU countries and Norway. And it has been progressing over years, but it takes a lot of time sometimes to be in place. Here, I just selected a picture of the room that is actually in Paris, because it took really a decade to set up this facility. And although there has been some difficulties and some resistance to implement this response, now it's well accepted, and there has been recently a report to document the fact that it provides services to many drug users, and there is evidence that this response, as part of other responses, can really work and contribute to reducing drug-related deaths. I will just show you as well some data on where we are with take-home naloxone programs in Europe in 2019. So as you can see, we've got some national programs, that's the dark blue, or some local regional programs in the pale blue countries. And as you see, most of the western part of Europe, we've got now the take-home naloxone programs. And what is important as well in terms of responses is that there has been changes with the pandemic. And in particular, this has affected some services like take-home naloxone, which are now available where they were not available before the pandemic. So what has changed? We had, on one hand, we had reallocated staff and resources. There was reduced capacity of the healthcare facilities. And of course, there is this economic recession and the question on whether there will be sustainable funding for the services. But on the other hand, what was really clear from this transporter exercise that we conducted is that there was adaptation of the services. There were in particular more housing, more shelters, and there were eased and facilitated prescription and delivery of opioid agonist treatment. And there was as well online consultations that were developed, and a lot of innovation working practices and some situations that have been really unlocked or deblocked. For example, in Portugal, where there has been some new mobile drug consumption rooms put in place, and as well in Greece, where things have been made possible by the context of the pandemic. Many of the partners in the countries reported that the collaboration between the local authorities and the NGOs have been absolutely essential in the adaptation of the services. So lots of lessons learned as well in terms of new working practices and collaboration. Some concluding remarks now about this overview of drug-related deaths and the drug situation in Europe. So since the early 2020, the COVID-19 pandemic has impacted all areas of the drug policy. And there has been European drug markets which has proven to be resilient to COVID-19 disruption. We've got health threats from high-strength products, and that's very evident for opioids, for heroin, but for stimulants as well. And in terms of opioids, it's important that Europe continues to be vigilant and is prepared to respond quickly and effectively to any increase in the threats observed in this area. Just to finish as well, as Europe's drugs program evolves, so too must all responses and monitoring. And the new EU drug strategy and action plan provide the framework for action to improve the public health and security. And actually, just put that in red, it's the EU Drugs Action Plan for 2021 to 2025 that has been adopted by the Council of the European Union on the 21st of June 2021. And there are it's a very ambitious action plan, and it's really looking forward. And it gives actually a key role to the agency and to our partners in the countries. It mentions really specific objectives related to reducing drug-related harm and drug-related deaths in particular. And it stresses the importance to monitor the situations, but to monitor as well the progresses made in the implementation of the responses that should prevent this death and save lives. Thank you very much.